Hi, my name is Roland and welcome to the Vectrix Rolly Show and to my Synchaesthetic Spectrum special. In case you're one of my younger viewers and you don't know what it is, the Synchaesthetic Spectrum was a line of home computers that came out in the 1980s and they were very successful, especially in the UK and other parts of Europe, and still today there is a huge fan base out there, and in this video I would like to show you the different types of machines. I don't have all original Spectrum computers in my collection, but I have the most important models, I would say. And here I want to focus on the old classic computer hardware, and there will not be much time to tell you about the games, the whole history, all the add-ons, and I cannot cover all the different emulators and newer Spectrum clones. There are many videos about the classic Synchaesthetic Spectrum computers on YouTube, but often they are not really structured. They show you some different machines here and there, and in some cases even using some stock photos from the web. I never really understood why someone would like to make a video about certain things without showing the real thing. That's not really helpful for people that are new to the Spectrum and are thinking about getting one. Like my video about the Commodore VIC-20 and also some other videos on my channel, this here is a 3D video, so if you want and you own proper 3D equipment, which is supported by YouTube, you can have a look at my computers here in 3D. There is a wide range of devices you can use, from cheap red blue anaglyph glasses up to the Oculus Rift, smart TVs, Google Cardboard add-ons and also the Nintendo New 3DS using the built-in web browser. This is only optional, it is always fun to see the machines pop out of your screen, so that you have the feeling we even can touch them, but you can also watch the standard 2D version of the same video. There are always a few people that complain that 3D technology is not ready yet, that they don't see any difference, and in 99% of the cases those people have eye issues, which they don't realize in daily life, only when they watch 3D content. By the way, in my last video, one of my viewers wanted to know if the 3D effect is some kind of video editing trick, but no, I use a Sony 3D video camera and it is quite tricky and more work to do proper 3D videos. Anyway, enough of that, let's start with the company Sinclair as such. The company was named after its owner and founder Clive Sinclair. He built many innovative consumer products starting back in the 1960s, like tiny pocket radios, calculators and handheld TVs, and even electric vehicles way ahead of its time. And what we see here is a portable flat screen TV that came out around 1984 as one example. This is a black and white TV and you might think now, this is a LCD TV. No, it isn't. This is a small CRT TV using a real picture tube, or a special version of a picture tube to be more specific. What we see here is the Synchaesthetic ZX81, a home computer that came out before the ZX Spectrum in 1981. This is a very limited entry-level computer that could show only black and white graphics, but we will not have a closer look at this machine here, as we will focus only on the Spectrum line of machines now. In case you want to know more, check out my ZX81 videos and you will even find a Sinclair related playlist on my channel. And don't forget to watch the video about the amazing port of the Dragon Slayer arcade game for that computer, and I will link to that in the description text below. The ZX Spectrum often was the first or second home computer people got. I guess, at least in the UK, many people had a Sinclair ZX81 or even an older ZX80 before. So let's start now with the first computer from the ZX Spectrum line, and if you are from the US you may have figured out in the meantime that I always say ZX instead of CX. You know, I'm not a native speaker, but ZX does sound more correct to me, maybe just because it is similar to what you would say in German language. Anyway, this here is the famous machine with the rubber keyboard, which was released in 1982. On the left side is my old original and scratched computer from back then. On the right side is a refurbished model. You could get a version with 48 kilobytes of RAM or a cheaper 16 kilobytes version. It uses a so-called Z80 CPU and it does not have any dedicated video hardware that can draw sprites, and there is no music chip built in here in this first version. All you get is some beeping sounds that come out of a tiny beeper within the computer. Well, maybe that's not the complete truth. Some programmers even managed to do polyphonic music and speech output using that beeper, but the sound quality was not really super exciting. If you want to use an external amplifier or active speaker, you can connect it to the cassette tape port and you get the sounds from the beeper also there. Like with most 1980s home computers, you also get the typical manuals to learn how to use the built-in programming language called BASIC. This computer was designed to be a low-cost mass-market consumer product, so there is no power switch, no joystick port built-in, the rubber keyboard is not really the best, you can connect a tape recorder to load and save programs and data, and there is an expansion port at the back where I can plug in, for example, joystick ports and disk drive interfaces. Sinclair brought the so-called Interface 1 and 2 to the market. With Interface 1 you could connect the ZX micro drives to your computer, which was a magnetic tape data storage system, and with Interface 2 you could use tiny ROM game cartridges, but only very few games were released on such ROM models. Most games were released on cassette tape. I'm not a Sinclair hardcore collector. Those add-ons like Interface 1 and 2 and the micro drives got very expensive over time on eBay, so I cannot show it to you here, but there are tons of web pages and YouTube videos out there showing that stuff in action. Those add-ons are interesting for collectors only. If you want to use a ZX Spectrum today, just buy modern add-ons like SD card or compact flash card drives, and I will show you that later. So let's connect one of my old tape recorders and let's load an original tape, which usually takes a few minutes. If you get a Spectrum and you don't have SD or compact flash drive already, you can also load games using tape recorders, MP3 players, mobile phones, or you can use your PC or laptop computer for example. Keep in mind that on some modern devices the volume level might not be high enough that it would work. You can also find some software on the web to transfer games from your PC to your Spectrum using the cassette interface, but this is only fun for some time. If you really want to use your computer on a daily basis, you definitely want to get some kind of modern flash drive solution. Most games also had loading screens, and on the original Sinclair computers you could also hear the beeping sounds from the data on the tape. It was possible to copy those games, so piracy was huge back then. Some people copied simply tape to tape using two tape recorders, but you got more reliable working copies using special copy software. So why did I buy such a rubber key Sinclair ZX Spectrum back in the days? My first home computer I ever got was a Texas Instruments TR-99-4A, and I showed that machine and some games on my channel, and I have a whole Texas Instruments playlist just in case you want to check that out. That TR-99 was very expensive to expand back then, memory expansions did cost a fortune, so I wanted to get a new computer with more memory. I bought the ZX Spectrum mainly to play games, and as my best friend had one, it was easy to get software, and I could just use a standard cassette tape recorder to store the programs, so I did not need to buy a special recorder like it was the case with Commodore and some other computers. The Spectrum was also one of the cheaper home computers back then. On the TR-99 I did write my own programs, on the Spectrum not so much, as I did not like the keyboard and that you had to press a specific key for each command when using the built-in programming language BASIC, but you could get tons of nice games and programs for that little computer, and this is what it made interesting for me. Next, let's talk about who would be interested in such a computer today. Of course, there are many others like me that had such a Sinclair computer back in the day, so they want one because they feel some nostalgia for it. And there are also a few younger people that are interested in classic 1980s home computers. The graphic capabilities are quite limited on the computer. You don't have a special chip that draws sprites on the screen. So programmers needed to do all that in software, which could get quite complicated. But on the other hand, that also helped that those developers had to be very creative when developing new games for the Spectrum. Screen resolution is 256 by 192 pixels, but all pixels of an 8x8 character block share the same foreground color and the same background color, so many games have a typical Spectrum look. But this should not give you the wrong impression now that Spectrum games were bad or looked like crap or something like that. It was more like that conversions of arcade games were not always the best on the Spectrum, as the original games were heavily relying on sprites hardware. The best games you could get for your Spectrum were those that were specifically developed for that machine. Once a viewer asked me what is the reason that I still use such old computers, if I could use an emulator instead. Well, that's because of nostalgia, and using just an emulator doesn't really give me the full experience. It is just like with vintage cars. Some people like them and still use them today, even they could get a new modern car instead. Anyway, the Spectrum computer is a PAL machine, and that first version only came with RF out. There are add-ons to get SCART RGB video out, or you can also mod your computer to get composite video. There are tons of instructions for that on the web, and it is quite easy to do. There was also an NTSC version available from Timex Sinclair, but it had some technical differences and was not fully compatible as far as I know. So if you want to use the PAL computer in the US, you need to replace the external power supply or use a power converter, and you have to use either a multi-standard monitor or a PAL NTSC converter together with the composite video out mod. What else is important to know? Of course, you can have the usual issues with old capacitors, as it is the case with most old hardware. There are horror stories that your RAM chips will die when using old capacitors. Don't know if this is really an issue, but I replaced the capacitors in the machines I use the most. I also added heat sinks to the chips of all of my Sinclair home computers. This is simple to do and not very expensive. Some of those old chips can get quite hot, especially the so-called ULA, which is a custom gate array chip. When you are doing that, you could also think about replacing the 7805 voltage regulator on your computer with a modern DC-DC converter, like one from Traco Power, for example. Those components work very reliable and don't generate any heat. If you don't feel comfortable doing such work yourself, there are companies offering repair services. What happens quite often with old Spectrum computers is that the keyboard is not working anymore, and in most cases you can fix that by simply replacing the old keyboard membrane with a new one. Here you can see two types of such old membranes, so that you get an idea how that looks like. You can buy new membranes from sellmyretro.com, and there you can buy even a new Repro keyboard faceplate if yours looks scratched, so your computer looks and works like new then. As black plastic was used by Sinclair for the case, you don't have any discoloration issues like with some old white home computers. You can play most games using the rubber keys, but it is more fun using a joystick, and your keyboard membrane will live much longer then. There were several different joystick standards available, like Kempston and Sinclair. If you use a Kempston compatible joystick interface, it will work even with many early titles then. What you see here is an original Kempston joystick interface I got as a gift from my aunt from England back then, so I have family there in Leeds. With that first original ZX Spectrum, you can play already tons of great games and also newer homebrew titles, at least if you got the 48K version or upgraded your 16K model to a 48K machine. I cannot show you many games here now, as this video would get too long then. I like the whole design and look of the machine, and I also like that it doesn't take much space on my desk. If you want to get the same computer in a slightly different look, you might want to get this version here. This is the so-called Spectrum Plus that came out in 1984. It looks a bit similar to the design of the more professional Sinclair QL computer, in case you know that. Almost everything is identical to the Rubber Key version. You can even use the same motherboard PCBs in both models. Only real difference is that the Plus version also has a reset button, and you also could add such a reset button to your old Rubber Key Spectrum. Maybe the new keyboard feels slightly better than the Rubber Keys, still there is also a keyboard membrane involved, so you might also need to replace that, and you can get the membrane version for the Plus computer also from sellmyretro.com. The next original model was the ZX Spectrum 128, which came out around 1985-1986. The most important new features included 128 KB of RAM, 3-channel audio, a RGB monitor port, and an improved BASIC editor. So they did not improve the graphic capabilities, and even that sounds like a bad idea, it was an advantage in the end as game developers did support the new Spectrum 128. You know, they always want to reach as many customers as possible with their games, so now they still could develop their game code for one single platform and just add then some music or a few more features or levels to the 128K version. In my opinion, this is the most sought after and most expensive original Spectrum computer, because this was the last real Sinclair computer before the entire computer product range and the Sinclair brand name were sold to Amstrad. And what is also important is that this is the most compatible of all 128K Spectrum computers, as it still works with most older programs and games written for the 48K computers. This model is also called Toast Rack because of the huge heatsink for the voltage regulator on the right side of the machine. If you live in the UK, you might be lucky and still might find such a machine on a flea market. Here in my country, in Austria, it is not likely to find one in the wild, and the prices on eBay are just insane. It took me years to get a working machine, basically a mix together parts of two Toast Rack computers to get one perfect machine. This is currently my weapon of choice for playing Spectrum games. When you want to get such a Toast Rack computer, take care, there are also Spanish versions out there, and I heard that you might run into compatibility issues with certain types of compact flash drives. You can use the original external power supply that came with the Toast Rack also on your older Rubber Key and Plus Spectrums, but not vice versa. You should not use your older power supply on the 128K versions. There is no built-in beeper anymore, all the sound comes from your TV speaker, and you can use a SCART RGB cable if your TV does support that, and you will get a crisp and nice looking picture in most cases. If you want to enhance video output of your 128K Spectrum machines, or you want to build a RGB cable yourself, I will link to a PDF file with tons of useful hints. If you want to buy a video cable, I always recommend the cables from Retro Computer Shack from eBay. They have hands down the best cables, and I don't get any money from the gentleman behind that company for saying that. The cables are always labeled properly, very helpful if you have many cables. Some even have a version number on it, so it seems that the learnings based on customer feedback are worked in newer versions of the cable. Now let's talk about sound. The sound that comes out of the system is mono, and you still can hear also the data sounds from your cassette tape recorder and the beeper sounds if they are used by the games. And all that is mixed together with the music from the sound chip, but unfortunately the volume levels are not really equal. This is an issue, for example, when a game uses beeper sounds for shooting while playing music in the background. So if you want to change that, you can buy a stereo mode kit from ByteDelight.com. I will put the link in the description below. What you do with that is that you solder a tiny PCB on top of your sound chip and add a 3.5mm stereo jack to your computer, there will get a stereo sound with equal volume levels. I modded all my three different 128K Spectrums and really like the results. Also, the music sounds much nicer in stereo. The older versions of that stereo mod kit even had a switch to select between two different mixer setups, which defined which channel is played on the left side and which on the right side, as some Eastern European Spectrum clones had a different setup here than original Sinclair machines. But on the latest version there is no switch anymore. I guess Ben, the developer of that mod kit, removed it, as most people would not really hear much of a difference, and you would need another hole in your Spectrum case for the additional switch. Anyway, you can attach active stereo speakers to your mod PCB, but if you plan to do that mod and you want to get a SCART RGB video cable from Retro Computer Shack I mentioned before, you should contact them, because if you ask, they will also make a stereo version of their RGB cable for you, which means the stereo sound does come out of your TV then, in case it has stereo speakers built in. Also, this machine is completely recapped and there are heat sinks on the chips. I did not build in a modern DC-DC converter, as I was not sure if the version I got would be sufficient also for the 128K spectrum. I thought that I might need more than 1A max when using also add-ons on the expansion board. But at least I replaced the old 7805 5V voltage regulator from the 1980s with a more modern one that can handle 2A max. So the heatsink still gets hot and my computer feels still authentic when touching it. The next thing I want to show you is the flash drive I already mentioned. I have two older models here, there are now new smaller versions available. On the left side is an old DIV IDE, on the right side a DIV IDE Plus, and they should work on most original Sinclair Spectrum computers. Both use compact flash cards, but you can also get versions using SD cards. You just drop your game files on the card, in most cases those can be so-called Z80 or TAP files. What I don't like with most models is that they are either huge and take a lot of space behind your computer, or they are tiny but then they do come without a case. My perfect dream solution would be a tiny one in a case using SD cards and with one additional Kempston joystick interface already built in, and I would not really need more than that. I also got the so-called K-Mouse Turbo interface you see here, and you can put it on top of the DIV IDE Plus. It adds a mouse port, joystick port and a video out check for some of the Spectrum versions, but this is only useful for test purposes to try out the computer without using RF out, as the picture quality is not really good enough. Does it make sense to use a mouse on the old Spectrum? You know, there are only a few programs and game hacks available that support the mouse, so it is not really a must have, but I still wanted to have that and it is quite fun. I put the whole K-Mouse Turbo interface into a case I got from an old joystick interface, as I don't really like PCBs without the case sticking out of my computer. It works great, only the LEDs on the PCB are way too bright, but I covered them with the case anyway. So now let's have a quick look how the whole DIV IDE solution works. It is quite simple. You put your game files on the card, then you press a button on your DIV IDE interface, a menu shows up and then you select the program you want to run. If you really want to use your ZX Spectrum and you want to play a lot of games, there is no way around a solution like that in my opinion. The game here is a nice homebrew space shooter game, it is called More TV Car, and the nice game music in the background is from a gentleman from Poland. His artist name is Jesz Mie, and he is well known also in the Sinclair Spectrum community for his chiptune music. If you want to buy a Spectrum, there is one issue you should know about, and that one really sucks. Sometimes the CPU on the board is not 100% working, so Sinclair sometimes used CPUs that were not really 100% okay. Almost everything works as usual, so the previous owner that sells you his Becky maybe doesn't even know about any problems. You can load the games using the cassette interface, you can play the games, graphics look fine, sound is fine. Only when you press the button on your new DIV ID flash drive to get the game selection menu, nothing happens. In such cases you need to replace either the CPU or the whole PCB in your computer, so it would be a good idea if you could test the computer before you buy it, or you buy it from a seller that already had a DIV ID before. If you want to get only one original classic Spectrum model, which version should you get? Well, it depends what you want. Some people only want an original 48K rubber key Spectrum with beeping sounds and nothing else. If you use a 128K version instead, you will get access to more games, including more great homebrew games with nice music, like the Castlevania game for example. So I personally would recommend either this Toastrack Spectrum 128 here, or if you cannot find it for a reasonable amount of money, the Grey Plus 2 model I will show you next could be a great plan B for you. The Grey Sinclair ZX Spectrum Plus 2 came out in 1986, shortly after the Amstrad takeover, so this is an Amstrad machine, even it is still Sinclair branded. You can get minor incompatibility problems with software that accesses certain ROM routines, but nothing really major. All the games I wanted to play did work, and this was my standard Spectrum machine before I got the Toastrack version you saw before. I guess Amstrad just did not have enough time to completely mess up the compatibility like they did with later 128K models then. So if you want the 128K machine and you cannot find the Toastrack version, go for this Grey Plus 2 model, but don't mix it up with the similar looking black 2A and 2B versions. I heard that those are not that compatible as this Grey version here. Those black 2A and 2B versions, which I cannot show you as I don't have them, also have a data cassette recorder built in, and there is nothing wrong buying them for a few bucks on a flea market, or I would also take one for free, but I personally would not pay insane eBay prices for the black versions. As on this Grey version you have a cassette recorder built in, you can even load an original tape if you want. Some developers made interesting looking loader programs. The downside is that most of the time you will not need the recorder part and it is a waste of space on your desk. If you buy such a computer, you should expect that you need to replace the belt in the tape recorder, and there you might need to clean and adjust the head. Again, you can also use the Grey Plus 2 power supply for all older previous Spectrum models. There are joystick ports available, and even they look like standard Atari 9-pin joysticks, they are wired differently, so that people would need to buy special crappy Sinclair branded Amstrad joysticks, so you would either need to build or buy adapter cables, or you just use an external joystick interface. On this version the keyboard feels quite okay for Spectrum standards. I also put in the stereo mod there I mentioned before. This is the older version with the switch to change between two different mixer setups. I used this Grey Plus 2 computer quite a lot in the past and was always happy with it. I only replaced it because I liked the design of the Toastrack version a bit more, and the Toastrack model is also a bit smaller. Before I will show you the next Spectrum model, let's have a quick look at some original game tapes I got here. I like the design of the covers. You could also get compilations with several games on one single cassette tape. I cannot go into details now as this video is already quite long. Maybe I will show you some games in future videos. But you did not get games only on ROM cartridges or tape, some even came on discs, and those were 3-inch discs. That format was not used by many computer vendors back then, and it can get quite hard and complicated to find 3-inch discs and replacement drives today. Those discs you could use on the ZX Spectrum Plus 3, which is the last official Spectrum computer I will show you now in this video here. Instead of a tape recorder you saw on the previous model, the Spectrum Plus 3, which came out in 1987, had a 3-inch disk drive built in. Some people replace it with a more common 3.5-inch disk drive, and you can also replace it with a more modern flash drive, and you can also attach an additional external disk drive at the back if you want, but I guess the easiest way is just to use the DIFF IDE device again I already showed you. Also here you would need an adapter cable or external joystick interface to use standard 9-pin joysticks, and you still can attach also an external tape recorder if you want by using a special cable. The power supply I used looks completely different than on early Spectrum machines. You can use that one also on the black so-called 2A and 2B models that have tape decks built in, but you should not use 2A and 2B power bricks on the Plus 3. I bought this machine years ago when I was going back to retro computing and wanted to get an Ultimate ZX Spectrum machine, but I really did regret it back then as many older games did not work on that computer. So if you want to know if it is worth getting a Plus 3, that can get a quite controversial topic, and it depends on whom you ask. Many diehard Sinclair fans think this is the ultimate machine with a disk drive and a nice keyboard, but if you just want to play some specky games, this computer here is not the way to go in my personal opinion. Those Plus 3 machines also did suffer from audio clipping issues, so the music and sound effects did sound pretty bad, and Amstrad fixed it on later 3B versions. I could fix that issue now on my Plus 3 here with the stereo mod kit, and if you also got this exact Plus 3 version with the same audio issues, I really can recommend putting in that mod. The main reason why some Spectrum fans prefer a Plus 3 model is also because they can put in an IDE interface and attach hard disks or compact flash drives directly to the motherboard then. On this machine I built in such an IDE interface, you can get that from several different companies, and I added an Intel compact flash card and there I put some games on it, so here I don't need the external DIFF IDE device. In that case, you also have to replace the ROMs in the computer with the so-called Plus 3E ROMs, which is an enhanced and more modern version of the standard ROMs, where they also removed some known bugs. I will put a link below if you want to know all the details about it. The whole thing also works on the black Plus 2E tape model, but not with the older grey Plus 2 version I showed you in this video. I'm using even an unofficial newer version of that Plus 3 ROM that can even load TAP files from the compact flash card, which is good as you will find many TAP files on the web, and the older Plus 3E ROM versions cannot handle those. I cannot tell you all the details now as there is not enough time for that, but I found it very complicated to set it all up and would have never managed to do that without help from some nice people from the Spectrum community. I even got a loader tool from a gentleman from Spain by the name of Miguel, and without that I would never have figured out myself how to start the games now without typing some complicated disk commands. You also could get a light gun for later Spectrum models, but I guess this is more interesting for collectors only. Most of you don't want to buy Spectrum because of the few light gun games released. If you really want to have some fun with a light gun, you'd better go for a PlayStation 1 or 2 for example. And I made a video about the PlayStation 1 light guns, so go and check that out if you are into that kind of things. I hope that this is not already too much information for you. I only would like to mention there is a whole universe of unofficial Spectrum clones out there, especially from Eastern European countries. Spectrum clones were a big thing there before people switched over to PCs, and you still can buy some of those interesting looking machines today. I only have one single computer in my collection. This is the Oral-B K08. And I showed it already on video a long time ago, and I will link to that. I called that video From Russia with Love. Some of my viewers informed me then later that the place where this machine was produced is in Ukraine, and that machine was quite easy to get complete boxed, as tons of new old stock was sold on eBay. You could get even a SCART RGB cable for that machine from Retro Computer Shack. Go and check out that video if you want to know more, and you can even watch it in 3D if you want. There are also tons of great web pages and YouTube channels covering the Syncasetic Spectrum, and here at the end of this video I would like to mention the World of Spectrum webpage, where you can find also thousands of games, and on YouTube there is one ultimate Syncasetic Spectrum channel, and that is The Spectrum Show, produced by Paul Jenkinson. This is one of my personal favorites on whole YouTube. If you have the slightest interest in that machine, do yourself a favor, go there and subscribe to his channel. His videos are like a TV show about that machine, and as I'm a filmmaker myself, believe me, this gentleman puts an insane amount of effort and work into his show. I honestly cannot understand why that show currently does have so few subscribers, while millions of people are watching stupid react videos. So please be so kind, go there and subscribe to The Spectrum Show, just to give me back some hope for mankind again. Is it worth getting a Syncasetic Spectrum for your collection? If you are only looking for one single 1980s 8-bit home computer and you like games that look slightly similar to the Nintendo Entertainment System, maybe go and check out the Commodore C64 first. Both for the C64 and Spectrum you get thousands of games and even many new homebrew titles. I feel a bit more nostalgia for the Spectrum as I had one back then, and I guess that's also the main reason I use the Speccy more than the C64. So I hope that was interesting and entertaining for you. You know, making videos is quite some work and very time consuming. And as this is a non-commercial hobby activity, this is a free service for you. So please consider subscribing to my channel to show your support. You will find a lot of stuff here you have not seen on a million other YouTube channels before. Please like, share, and feel free to leave a comment. Say hello to us also on Facebook. And as always, thanks for watching.